Good evening. Good evening, and thank you so much, Martha, for that lovely introduction. It is a great pleasure to be with you all. I can already tell that this is not simply an organization. It's a community and a very lively and engaged and caring and interconnected community. So I feel delighted to be among you. I believe that I probably spent time with you before without us knowing one another. When I was here for those 20 years, I marched many times against more foolish wars than we would like to count. And I'm sure that we were together, some of us, in that. And I am glad that you are still carrying out this important work and, in fact, expanding it to take up issues like in economic and environmental justice and so forth. So I am really pleased to be with you. I would especially like to thank Catherine Mutton for reaching out to me initially and to the board who have been so wonderful and supportive in this. And I am really happy to be with you. And it's nice to be happy about something because I think we all know that our political system is in pretty deep crisis at this point in Washington and in many of the states, including my own. A government that is supposed to be of, by, and for the people is in crisis. And even at this point, elementary norms of civic decency and humanity and truth are in crisis. You know this, and that's why you're here and why so many of you are already active. But what you might be struggling to figure out is how we got here and what that means. The watershed that we've reached in our public life in America has been fed by many streams, some of which have received a lot of attention from journalists and historians. They include the kind of movement conservatism that made Barry Goldwater, the Republican candidate for president in 1964, just after he voted against the Civil Rights Act of that year. They also include the religious right. They also include, these streams include the white supremacist right, which has resurfaced with such a vengeance over the last year. And all of these are important streams that have led us to this point, and all of them have produced votes to effect radical policy change. But I'm here tonight to tell you about another piece of the puzzle of how we got into the dangerous situation in which we now find ourselves, a missing piece of the puzzle. And that is the ideas that are guiding the billionaire-funded libertarian right made popular by Charles Koch. And I believe that this is the crucial piece that we have missed because it explains so much that otherwise seems so mysterious. It's also crucial because knowing about this piece may equip citizens like all of us here tonight to lead the way out of this mess before it is too late. And as Catherine, as a public health nurse, I don't know where she went, but I quote her all the time on the circuit now. She said, speaking as a former nurse, that you need to get the diagnosis right before you can determine the best treatment plan. And I think that's a great analogy for the situation we're facing now. Because also there's an unmarked hazard in our situation in the United States right now, that the noisiest threats, among them, the chronic race baiting and bullying coming from the White House, the noisiest threats are getting the most attention. But as that spectacle draws nearly all media and voter attention, an even more extreme plan is moving along apace. In the 30 states now totally dominated by a radicalized Republican Party, in federal and state agencies, and in the courts. And this plan is being pursued by a much smaller cause, but one that is archly determined and breathtakingly well-funded. And this cause aims to rewrite the rules of our society and our government and our legal system permanently. More than that, this cause has shown that its leaders are willing to use those other popular sections of the right, the religious right and the white supremacist right, to get what they want. I'll state my case simply. Behind all the seeming chaos and dysfunction in our public life right now, there is a strategy in play, a cold-eyed, calculated strategy. And that strategy is far along. One of its field generals said this in 2015. "We are close to winning," he said. "They," meaning the critics and the rest of us, "they don't have the real path. They don't have the real path. That was Mark Holden, the head of Koch Industries' government and public affairs operation, gloating to an invitation-only audience of billionaire and multimillionaire donors. Now, you've heard a lot in the last several years about the fortune that Charles Koch and his network of donors have been investing in our politics. But what you have likely not heard about is the ideas, the technology, as Koch refers to them, and this is a man with three engineering degrees from MIT. When he says technology, he means ideas that enable a breakthrough. What you probably have not heard about is these ideas that have made his investments lately so devastatingly effective after 30 years of investing. Or, I'm sorry, now almost 50 years of investing. And I learned through the course of my research that it was an academic economist who taught Charles Koch that for capitalism of the variety that they want to thrive, democracy must be enchained. Democracy in Chains, the book that I'm here to talk to you about, provides the unknown backstory of this defining moment in which we find ourselves as it uncovers that real path to which Mark Holden referred. In its essence, the book is a story of two men, a thinker and a CEO, whose lives converged through a shared commitment to transform the model of government that our country built up through waves of citizen action over the course of the 20th century. The thinker was a Tennessee-born economist, James McGill Buchanan, who spent most of his career in Virginia institutions, beginning in Charlottesville in 1956. The CEO is, of course, the Kansas-based Charles Koch, who spent most of his adult life, when he wasn't turning Koch Industries into one of the most profitable privately held corporations in the world, spent most of his adult life seeking a way to make our country, and the world, in fact, and we can come back to that, conform to his arch version of economic liberty, a free-reign capitalism beyond the reach of voters and their governments. The history that my book conveys is first of the crucible in which James Buchanan came up with this idea of enchaining democracy to insulate economic liberty. And that was as the civil rights movement made headway in Virginia and the nation in the late 1950s and 1960s. And then it is a story about how Charles Koch funded an apparatus to make that idea a reality, in a messianic quest that has produced the volatile situation we are now confronting. I have to admit, it is not a comforting story. Several readers have written to me and compared it to a Stephen King novel. I have not read any Stephen King novels, but I took their point that it is scary. But at the same time, I truly believe that knowing what we're up against is vital to assessing how best to defend a democracy that many of us now understand is facing existential threat. Knowledge can be empowering. I firmly believe that, both as a scholar and as a citizen. And that's also what I'm hearing back from readers who are saying things like, it feels like the curtain has been pulled back and we can finally see what is going on. And again, I think seeing what is happening is also helpful in thinking about what to do about it. But rather than lecture in a conventional way, what I wanted to do was share with you how I stumbled on the trail that led me to the conclusions that I just shared. Because I think that knowing the route that led me to these conclusions will give you an even sharper sense of the stakes of what is happening. Because it turns out that what we're seeing now is not the first time the libertarian right has shown itself willing to exploit white supremacy to advance the cause of what I've come to think about as property supremacy, a property supremacy that will affect us all, whatever our backgrounds and current standing. And the trail that led me to this conclusion also reveals the surprising role that some scholars and universities have played in bringing us to this point, a history that I think any of those of us who are connected with higher education need to reckon with. So what led me to these stark conclusions? In a word, serendipity. I'm a historian of social movements in the United States with a particular interest in the US South. And about 10 years ago, I was finishing up another book, and I came across the tragic tale of Prince Edward County, Virginia, whose white officials answered the U.S. Supreme Court's call to desegregate its public schools without further delay by, as the White County officials put it, quote, going out of the public school business entirely. They shuttered their entire public school system. They even posted no trespassing signs on the closed schools. And they left black children in the county with no formal education whatsoever as the county's white children headed off to a private segregation academy. And the county officials kept the schools, public schools shut for 5 years until the courts finally compelled them to reinstate a public school system. Shocked by this story and embarrassed that I had never come across it as someone who's done work on the history of the U.S. South, I began to research. And I very quickly found that tax-funded school vouchers from the state of Virginia were crucial to this story. And I also found that the University of Chicago economist, Milton Friedman, had issued his first manifesto for such vouchers in 1955 in the full knowledge of how that would be used in the South, where segregationist officials were threatening to shut down public education rather than allow black and white children to sit together in classes. So Friedman became part of my story, and I realized that instead of this being what it was usually portrayed as being sort of the last gasp of Jim Crow, this might actually be a kind of early birth cry of what sometimes is called neoliberalism, sometimes free market fundamentalism. But anyway, I was intrigued and I continued to research. And in following a footnote, I learned of a 1959 report as this threat from Prince Edward County officials was in the air to shut the schools in the fall by two other economists who had set up a center at the University of Virginia in Charlottesville in 1956, and one of them was the man I mentioned, James McGill Buchanan. The two economists issued this report in a deliberate effort to refute the moderate whites, including some of their own colleagues at the university, the moderate whites who were trying to save Virginia's public school system. And what the economists did was make a case that essentially the moderates had the math wrong. And if the state sold off all of its facilities, all of its school buildings and resources to private operators, they said, it could provide better education without having to comply with the federal courts. So their report, in effect, called for privatizing Virginia's schools before that verb even existed in our national vocabulary. And they did so in the full knowledge that the schools thus funded would be white segregation academies because those were the only private schools in question. And in fact, black Virginia parents and their organizations opposed these vouchers to a person and took them as an affront to their civic dignity that had just been recognized in the Brown decision. Now, needless to say, as a professor myself, it stunned me to see two university professors making a case for what their state's most arch segregationists were seeking. And it intrigued me that they did so not in racist terms, but in economic terms, leveraging the authority of their discipline to back up what the most anti-democratic figures of the day in their state were seeking. James Buchanan and his colleague Warren Nutter knew that they were exploiting the rage of white supremacists to move their libertarian economic agenda. When they referred to as the free society, even as they showed no sympathy whatsoever for the civil rights activists whose mantra was freedom now. The cover letter that they sent to state officials, including to one who had sponsored five laws taking away the First Amendment freedoms of the NAACP, the cover letter that they said that they sent said that they were sending out this report, quote, letting the chips fall where they may. Letting the chips fall where they may. And that phrase just lodged itself in my gut and left me wondering, as an educator myself, how anyone could do something like this, not in irrational frenzy, but in cold-eyed calculation. So my curiosity piqued, I began to seek out more information about this James Buchanan. And I learned that he had won the Nobel Prize in Economic Sciences in 1986. He was awarded the prize for having pioneered a new way of thinking called public choice economics, which also, I learned, became influential in political science and law and among activists and elected officials on the right. What Buchanan did that was new was, in his phrase, the economic analysis of politics. But it was a distinctive economic analysis. What he did was apply Chicago-style libertarian economics to political actors of all kinds to say that they could only be understood as individuals pursuing their rational, personal self-interest, not the common good, as they claimed. And Buchanan's specialty was public finance, questions of taxation and government spending. And as a thinker who identified with the political right, his mission became finding ways to lower taxes and reduce the public sector, also effectively to defame government, one could say. With this public choice economics, he turned new attention to what he liked to call the rules of the game of politics, to the spending incentives of the political process, and to how altering the rules of that process could yield different outcomes. And I want to make clear that there are other people who have found these public choice ideas useful. For example, the law professor Cass Sunstein, who worked on regulatory matters for President Obama. He's just one. But Buchanan's version of these ideas, the Virginia School of Political Economy, was always distinctive. And Buchanan himself said, looking back in a documentary in 2007, that when he set to work in the late 1950s, the idea of the public interest was dominant, the idea that people in public life worked to advance the public interest and the common good. And he said, "That's what I wanted to tear down. That's what I wanted to tear down." And again, I thought, why would anyone want to do that? Reading more, I learned that to a libertarian like Buchanan, there is no common good. Any such notion of shared purpose, in their view, will lead government to coerce those who don't agree with the majority. Democracy, Buchanan and his colleagues came to argue, violates the individual liberty of the minority. And the minority that he was always concerned with was that of wealthy taxpayers and corporations who didn't share the majority's view of the public interest. Government, Buchanan and his colleagues argued, all but steals the property of such people if it taxes them for purposes they don't share. We are not our brother's keeper. It was essentially his mission to insist, or at least we should not be able to use government to shift tax revenues from one citizen to another. And he came to talk about all of this in very stark and foreboding terms, terms that are now widespread on the right, owing to decades of inculcation of Buchanan's team's ideas by his team and the think tanks with which they worked. A case in point, many of you may remember when Mitt Romney on the campaign trail spoke disdainfully of those he called the 47%. He was at a dinner for $50,000, a plate dinner for donors, and he said that 47% of Americans would never vote for him because they were too dependent, in his phrase, on government as net tax recipients. And when he did that, millions of Americans were shocked. But the thing is, Romney wasn't offering a new idea here. This was Buchanan-style thought, and by then, the Heritage Foundation was already producing something they call the Annual Index of Dependency to chart what Romney was speaking about. But it was Buchanan who gave scholarly imprimatur to such thinking. And he actually spoke of net tax recipients as, and I quote, parasites on the productive. He also warned of predators and prey, the predators being people like say, senior citizens who wanted a drug benefit, or public school teachers who were trying to reduce class sizes and get more resources into the schools, or environmentalists who were trying to get government to clean up waste sites, all of these things. These were the predators, and the prey were the unwilling taxpayers. I think even hearing those words, you can understand that what we're looking at is a dehumanizing vocabulary that makes fellow citizens look like menaces from the animal world. I know from my first book, On the Far Right, that this is a vocabulary that is disinhibiting, a vocabulary that licenses hostility. And it, too, is rife on the right today. As I read more, I learned, too, that for those who think this way, justice is a simple matter. As one of Buchanan's colleagues, a man named Walter Williams, who co-hosts Rush Limbaugh's show often, he said on the stump in my state recently, here's my definition of social justice. I keep what I earn, you keep what you earn. So the idea is that you collectively can only legitimately tax me if I agree with all of your goals and methods. But Buchanan didn't stop here. Believing this way, he moved in the 1970s from scholarship to organizing, to urging right-wing donors to build up what he called a counterintelligentsia by using what he called a gravy train to bring men in to the libertarian fold, he said, train them in a set of values and train them for this kind of intellectual battle. And as he was organizing, he also shifted from analysis to prescription, to what he called constitutional economics, in the belief that all existing constitutions in the world were failures as far as protecting the wealthy from the majority, he set out to design a legal regime that could protect capitalism from government, that could enshrine the rights of the wealthy minority to a degree that no society anywhere had yet done. And his timing in this proved to be propitious, because he found an eager audience among some Latin American generals in need of a new constitution. In 1980, the military junta of General Augusto Pinochet in Chile, through its civilian partners, invited Buchanan to Santiago to try out his ideas for how to devise a constitution to protect capitalism from government. A constitution that would shield what the dictatorship had wrought in Chile from an eventual return to elected government. And the result, what they called the Constitution of Liberty, is still in effect today in Chile. In 2013, a president who was elected by two-thirds of the Chilean people, Michelle Bachelet, complained about how this constitution's, what she called, authoritarian trammels were keeping her from delivering on what that supermajority was asking of her, including a huge movement of students that had brought up to 1 million people to the streets in a much smaller country than ours, because after the school privatization, Chile had the highest cost education in the OECD world. She couldn't deliver to the people who had voted her into office because, as she put it, the Constitution put locks and bolts on what the government can do. Not checks and balances, which I think we'd all agree with, but locks and bolts. And I'm sorry to have to report that this is not a matter of purely historical interest. That kind of constitution, a constitution with locks and bolts, is coming to America, thanks to pressure from the Koch donor network and its allies in the trenches, who are determined to achieve the kind of binding change that Buchanan urged without informing the rest of us, the public, of their true goals. And thanks to assiduous organizing by the apparatus these arch right-wing donors fund, above all, the American Legislative Exchange Council, ALEC, and a Republican party that the donors have now all but taken over and turned into a delivery vehicle using the threat of primary challenges to make people toe the donors' line rather than be accountable to even Republican voters. Thanks to all of that, this cause now has in place as of this past week with Wisconsin authorizing 28 of the state's authorization needed to call a constitutional convention. You need 34 states to call a Section 5 constitutional convention. They now have 28. Let's be clear about this. We have not had such a thing in the United States since our Constitution was drafted. We have not had a constitutional convention since 1787. This is an incredibly radical vision, and it is perhaps a few years away at the rate things are going if it is not stopped. This is the real path that Mark Holden referred to, getting control of the states to ultimately change the national rule book. Now, you may be wondering how I was able to put together the way that Buchanan's ideas were guiding this real path of the Koch network to shackle democracy. And the answer is, again, coincidence. I happened to move to North Carolina in 2010, just as a radicalized Republican Party dominated by Koch-backed Tea Party figures won majorities in both houses of the state legislature. And suddenly, the things I was reading in Buchanan's work that still seemed so abstract became incredibly concrete and real as the North Carolina General Assembly's lead donor, a man named Art Pope, whose name may be familiar to you, boasted of the big bang his grantees were delivering to make this once moderate state, again another boast, a laboratory for the cause, using a technology that came from this public choice economics. So what did I see happening in North Carolina? This was Big Bang was a kind of shock and awe style rollout of radical changes on so many fronts that it was dizzying. It was hard for people to keep up or even know what to focus on. And Buchanan had long argued to his colleagues and those he worked with and funded and the think tanks he's engaged with that they needed, if they wanted to see radical change, they had to stop focusing on who rules, who is in office, who is elected, and think instead about the rules and how the rules would shape whoever was elected. And he explained this to like thinkers and those who funded them, including Charles Koch, that if you wanted to get this kind of radical change that libertarians did, when most of the population did not want such a change and they knew it from repeated experience, you had to focus laser-like on systematically changing the rules of governance. We could say, as Chile did in 1980, although Buchanan never mentioned in his publications his work on that constitution. It was a kind of guilty secret, I think. But what I watched unfold in North Carolina after this new legislature came in early 2011, much like yours, your neighbor Wisconsin under Scott Walker, what I saw was a stunning barrage of radical rules changes on this model. One after another, the most radical gerrymander in our history in order to misrepresent the will of the electorate. New measures to undermine workers' ability to organize together in unions, particularly public sector unions. Attacks on public education at all levels and radical cuts in funding for it. Repeal of a hard-won Racial Justice Act to ensure fairness in the policing and the criminal justice system. Refusal to accept the Medicaid expansion of the Affordable Care Act despite a crying need for health care among those who made too much to qualify for Medicaid as that was written and too little to be able to afford health care on their own. Rolling back measures to protect the environment and reduce global warming. Also, in all of this, breaking with customary governing practices like public hearings before passing significant legislation or transparency about the process. Instead, what we saw is the legislators moving with breakneck speed and secrecy. And then, to cap it all off, they passed what a group called Democracy North Carolina, a great civic group, called, rightly, the Monster Voter Suppression Bill. And what proved surreal to me, both as a scholar and as a citizen, was that I could see that this new Republican majority was applying James Buchanan's ideas to get what they otherwise could not, what they could not have gotten if they campaigned openly on the measures that they were putting through. But also unsettling was how critics of all of this, good, well-intentioned people, people who had become my friends, people who were shocked at the U-turn their beloved state was taking, how they were missing the deep operational strategy that unified all of these varied measures. They couldn't see that the men who were pushing this agenda were not misinformed about the likely consequences of the agenda they were pushing. They fully understood that they would be inflicting grievous harm on many of their fellow citizens, that at least 5,000 North Carolinians, public health people said, would die as a result of lacking access to that insurance. Students would have their learning harmed for their lives from the changes that were going on in our schools. They understood they were inflicting harm, but they believed that their end game was worth the price. They were, you could say, letting the chips fall where they may. And what my fellow critics of all of this also could not see was that this agenda was backed by an ethical system. An ethical system that gave these actors confidence and let them feel heroic enough to weather the criticism and opposition they were facing. I can understand why it was hard for people who hadn't been doing the deep dive into libertarianism that I had been doing to see this, because it's an ethical system that is antithetical to every one of the world's major religious traditions. But it has its own stark coherence that we need to understand if we are to know how to deal with the crisis that Buchanan's ideas and Koch's money have created. So let me make this concrete. The libertarian morality deems it better to have people die from lack of health care than to receive it from government, from taxes paid for by others. And that ultimately is what they really mean when they talk about personal responsibility. You should be on your own. And if you fail to save for your future needs, you deserve your fate. And maybe your neighbors or other people in your community watching what happens to you will take a lesson and they will become more responsible. I learned all of this and more in 2013 when James Buchanan died, and finally that September I got access to his private archive at George Mason University. And in his records going back to the 1950s, I found my developing understanding confirmed in a way that literally took my breath away. There were times when I had to say to myself, Nancy, breathe, keep breathing, because I was so stunned at some of what I was finding. And I will give you just one example. In his private office, I found stacked, helter-skelter, on a chair, a pile of documents that exposed how Charles Koch and operatives from a number of the organizations that he funded then and still funds had collaborated with George Mason University economics faculty and higher administration in order to establish a base camp for this project, an academic base camp for this political project just across the Potomac from Washington, D.C., in this public university. And when I brought home the hundreds of documents I had copied at Buchanan House and put them together with the other sources I had compiled, I found myself laying down pieces of a puzzle that astounded me in its audacity and its scope. That project now encompasses dozens of ostensibly separate national organizations whose names may be familiar to you, the Cato Institute, the Heritage Foundation, and ALEC, for example. And if you include the state-level operations that make up something called the State Policy Network, and the international affiliates of what is called the Atlas Network, with operations in over 90 countries, we are talking about hundreds of organizations that are working to radically alter government and society, to bring this kind of unfettered, free-reign capitalism into being without being honest with the people. And that is the crucial point for me and something that we can come back to in discussion. But also as a historian, and a historian with particular long focus on the U.S. South, I came to realize something else. The form of government that these men see as ideal liberty, as the free society of their dreams would be a lot like mid-century Virginia in all but the state-forced racial segregation. When James Buchanan set to work in Charlottesville, Virginia in 1956 with an avowed mission to preserve liberty, that state had just been identified by a great political scientist named V.O. Key as the most oligarchical state in the South and therefore in the nation. Next to Virginia, V.O. Key wrote, and this was a man who had a nice, sharp sense of humor. Next to Virginia, Key wrote, Mississippi is a hotbed of democracy. If you, those who know your mid-century Mississippi will catch the reference. But think about it for yourself in light of what I've just said and what you've been watching for over a decade now. What really is the substance of this vision of liberty being imposed on us by the Koch donor network, but mid-century Virginia, the state that, again, in V.O. Key's words, was subjected to the most thorough control by an oligarchy? But now, the Koch network wants to graft these tools of elite domination onto the nation as a whole. And as I said, of course, the state-mandated racial oppression would go. But I think that we need to realize that nearly everything else about the political economy of mid-century Virginia enacts their dream. Let me just run through a little bit of it because it's going to sound eerily familiar. The use of right-to-work laws and other ploys to keep working people powerless. The suspicion of higher education as a source of subversion. The ability to fire dissenting public employees at will, targeting educators in particular. The insistence that government should not be allowed to stop discrimination. The deployment of states' rights legal arguments to prevent the federal government from promoting equal treatment. The regressive tax system and refusal to make forward-looking public investments. The opposition to Social Security and Medicare, which was led by two Virginians in Congress. And the parsimonious response to public needs of all kinds, from decent schools to public health care and more. Voting rights restrictions to make sure that those unlikely to support this system would be kept away from the polls. In short, rules that in combination ensured the uncontested sway of corporations and the wealthiest and most opposed to the public sections of the population. And the question I think this stealth plan we're seeing now presents other Americans with, once we know it, is at one level quite simple. Is this the kind of world that we want to live in and the kind of world that we want to bequeath to our children and to future generations? That, I believe, is the real public choice. But because I know, I think, how you in this audience will choose, I don't want to end on that note, but instead I want to close with some ideas about what we can do about this stealth plan once we understand it. And I hope we'll take this up more in the discussion, but I would say three things to me really follow from the history of what I've just described to you, also informed by my own history in researching and teaching the history of social movements. First, I believe that we need to get out of our particular silos and into conversation with those who share our values and our concern about where our country is heading. I know that some of you are doing this now in this group in something called the People's Lobby in Chicago that's trying to bring together people from different constituencies to develop shared visions for how we might go forward together. I think this is crucial because this libertarian right that I wrote about is really, and I say this as a historian, seeking to undermine the entire 20th century model of government built up by citizen action. It seems preposterous when I say it to you, but what makes it possible is the amount of money being put into this, and we have allowed inequality in our society to develop to such an extent that there is that money at hand for the people who are interested in doing this. Okay, so getting out of the silos, getting into common conversation, as you were saying before, David. So, you know, it's no longer that we can just have some people defending union rights here and some people fighting environmental degradation there and some people dealing with reproductive rights here. We are all in this together. And until we recognize that, it's going to be very hard to make headway. But making that happen, I think, also means getting out of our comfort zones. Each one of us trying to stretch ourselves to do more than we might have otherwise, to get into conversations with others that we haven't met, that we might not even feel comfortable talking to, but who are also endangered, that is going to be crucial. I take inspiration from the black feminist, Bernice Johnson Reagan. Some of you may remember her from the Albany Freedom Movement in Georgia and from the group Sweet Honey in the Rock. She wrote a brilliant piece about coalition building where she said, stretch your perimeter. If you are not feeling the strain, you're not doing the work. Second, as we come together across those former divisions, as we recognize and expand our sense of who we the people are, I think we also have to have some, and again, okay, self-interest, whatever my discipline, but I believe in the power of history. And I think it would help us to remember that past crises of this magnitude in our history have also proved to be opportunities for national renewal. Democratic forces only triumphed over the enemies of collective self-government time and again by redefining the meaning of citizenship and the purposes of our institutions. In the two moments I believe are most like our present moment, the 1860s and the 1930s, we saw this. We saw how after the Civil War, radical reconstruction was needed to truly end slavery and defeat the planter class by enfranchising freedmen, something that would have been unimaginable. 20 years before that. We saw this again in the Great Depression, that the New Deal was needed to push back those, again, that I've come to think of as the property supremacists, who said that the government shouldn't do anything about the mass suffering of the Depression. And had that prevailed, we likely would have had some version of fascism or communism. There was a polarization like that developing, but the fact that some people got out and worked for something else meant that liberal democracy survived and thrived for generations. To quote Naomi Klein, that I know some of you revere, and I do too, no is not enough. People need a vision to say yes to if they're going to make the commitment needed to prevail over this push for plutocracy. My last piece of advice, though, is don't panic. The single most important finding of my book is this, that the Koch donor network is doing what it's doing in the way that it's doing it because the architects of this plan know from repeated experience that if Americans are told the truth about what this libertarian right is actually seeking and ultimately seeking, they'll reject it and try to stop it. I believe that the right's fear of an alert and engaged and opposed majority is a colossal, colossal source of potential strength. All the strength that will be needed to root out this demolition project. And that means, too, that the single most important thing that needs to be done, that we need to engage in the work of, is informing and activating the millions of good people who will, I firmly believe this, who will seek to stop this if they understand, if they see what is being imposed on them and how. They will respond, and I believe that our job collectively as engaged citizens is to try to be part of that process of informing and activating people. And I welcome also your ideas as we shift now to discussion. Thank you.